the world of circumcision. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. He said, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if another man think that he hath the world, he might trust in the flesh, he said, I more. And here again, Paul displays just a small part of his resume. He says, circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews. As touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteous which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Also, I had this thing in Bibles at one point. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. He says, and here's my hope, to be found in him, not having mine own righteousness of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. And here's the nitty-gritty of what I want us to look at this evening. He says in verse 11, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Notice he said, I might attain. He says, not as though I had what? Already attained. Either world already perfect. But I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. And he says again, he says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. But Paul says, if I don't know anything else, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are were behind, and doing what? Reaching forth unto those things which are before. He says in verse 14, I press forward, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. If you would allow yourself to imagine someone running a race and they're getting close to the finish line and their goal is to obtain the prize. In most races, there's only one prize because second prize is not, you didn't win, amen. You win when you get first prize. So imagine someone in a race and they're racing against somebody and they come to the end, and we've seen it in the Olympics, and at the end, they, with all they had left in them, they were pressed forward. They were basically stretched forward with the purpose of being the first one to cross the line. Paul says, as I move closer to heaven, he says, I'm giving it my best shot. He said, I'm making a stretch for it. He said, I have not yet attained. I have not yet apprehended. I am not yet perfect. But this one thing I know, if I look back and see where I'm, amen, my competition is. If I look back to see where everybody else is, if I look back to see what the devil is doing, I'm not going to win. Amen. Paul says, I press, I stretch forward. One thing about a child of God, and I pray that this is your attitude, and I believe it will get us where we need to be. I won't miss heaven for a lack of effort on my part. Now there are some things that I know we tend to kind of, you know, halfway do, amen. And some things that we don't give our best. But when it comes to trying to get to heaven, let me encourage you that you always stretch forward. You always are reaching toward the mark. Never give it a halfway, because some people sometimes, well, I don't know if the church is right, but just in case, amen. Some people say just in case. And we always say, God knows my heart. Well, he does know your heart. So if your heart is saying, I'm going to stay with the Church of Christ just in case, God knows it.
Amen.
You must be fully convicted.
Amen.
You must be firmly, Brother Hubbard, You must be fully converted. A one-third conversion, a three-quarters conversion, a seven-eighths conversion is not going to get you. You must be fully converted. And know that if you don't make it, it wasn't because of your lack of effort. Put everything you have into going to heaven. Some individuals put all they have into attaining a certain goal, whether it's their health. They want to be the healthiest person around. They want to be the wealthiest. They want to be the most famous person. And then they put no time into trying to get to heaven. That ought not be the case. For a child of God, Matthew 6:33, first and foremost in my life should always be seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And he's in all these other things. Those beautiful things, he said, I'm going to take care of those. So Paul says, he said, you know what, I haven't made it yet. I'm not perfect yet. But Paul said, and I love the way he says, it's almost poetic. He says in verse 11 of Philippians chapter 3, if by any means, he says, I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Paul said, if I get there, he says, not as though I had already, he said, I want you to understand, I'm not saying I've already gotten there. He says, I want you to understand, I'm not saying I'm already perfect. He says, but I'm staying on the path. He says, I follow after. He says that if I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended for Christ. And then he says in verse 13, brethren, I count not myself. Paul said, I have not gotten there yet. And we need to understand, we are not where we need to be yet. That's why we should be motivated, amen, to continue to run this race. He says, but this one thing I do, and here's the part that trips up so many of us. He says, forgetting those things which are behind, some of us, and you know who you are, amen. You picked up something on January 1st, 2015, and you've been dragged around like a ball and chain all year long. Even when someone has offered to help you to lift your burden, you have still chosen to drag that, whatever it is, that weight throughout this year. And then you say things like, ooh, I sure am tired. I'm wore out. I don't know what's going on. Well, you're dragging that same thing for 364 days instead of just letting it go. Jesus says, come unto me, right? Do we not believe that? Do we not believe that he cares for us? Do we not believe that? Do we not believe that anything we're dealing with, God has the power to remove from us? Amen. But for whatever reason, we choose to just drag something and drag it and drag it, and then we want to give up. And there's no cause. Paul says, forgetting those things which are behind and doing what? Reaching forth unto those things which are before. What's before us? Before me, I see heaven. I see heaven. But I can't get to heaven if I'm concerned about those things behind. And Solomon said it the best thing I could ever say. He says, what's crooked?
Can't be made straight.
Can't be made straight. Solomon said, leave it alone. Can't go back and change it. What's useful about our past? We can learn from it, right? But we can't go back and change anything.
Amen.
We can't go back and change anything that's happened, even the last 3 seconds. So I know it's impossible for you to go back and change something 20 years ago. But what can I do? I can keep forward. I can press forward. And Paul says, I forget those things which are behind. I'm reaching forward to those things which are before. And he says, I press or I stretch. And think about that Olympic runner. Right there at the finish line, and there's competition there, and they really, really want this prize. So what do? They press toward the mark. And in this case, in a spiritual sense, we press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So my prayer this evening is that you will hold on to this, that we've come too far to turn around.
Amen.
Say this with me. We've come
too far.
To turn around. We've come too far to turn around. Y'all like to scare to say it. We've come too far to turn around. And now, Brother Bishop, you may sit down. But let me leave you with this. Here's one of the problems that we have. The number one reason, and too many times we see people give up. Too many times people say, you know, I'm not in this race, but I've gone weary, I've gone tired, and God never said you wouldn't go weary and tired.
Amen.
He just said, don't faint. We're going to go weary, we're going to go tired, amen. But don't faint, don't give up. So we're going to become fatigued at different points, spiritually, mentally, physically, everything, as you live the life of a Christian, because it's not easy.
Nope.
It's not easy, because if it was, everybody would be doing it. So it's not an easy task. But let me remind you that it is the most worthwhile thing that you can take on in your life, to live the life of a Christian. But too many times, Christians, they give up. Too many times they give up. And one of the reasons why people give up, maybe the number one reason why people give up so fast, because sometimes you see a Christian, man, they get out there, they keep running, next thing you know, they're giving up. And even those of us who move kind of slow, Brother Mattis, Brother McAwee, even those of us who move kind of slow sometimes, slow motion and slow boat, amen. Sometimes we give up. And you know what? One of the main reasons why people give up so fast is because they tend to look at how far they still have to go instead of how far they've come. He said, boy, I got a long way to go. How about I look at it this way? Not that I have a long way to go, but look at how far I've come. Because when you think about how far we really have to go to get there, that can be tiring sometimes. But what encourages me is that I look at the man, look how far I've come. Look at how far I've come. We've come too far to turn around. If you're here this evening, you're not a child of God, I encourage you to don't give up. Press forward. Lean into it. As you go into this year, lean into it. Do something different in the church. Be part of a different ministry. Take part of a different ministry. The way the ones you've been working on and stuff, so get on another ministry. Do something different. Become part of the visitation ministry. And see the pleasure you bring into the eyes of those when you go out and visit those who are sick and shut in. Become part of that. Get in the kitchen. Bake a cake. Do something. Amen. Help Brother Bishop clean the building. Ain't no takers on that one. By the way, somebody raise their hand. I do it, preacher. But do something different this year. Press forward. Don't give up. Don't look at how far we have to go. But look at how far you've come. You've come too far to turn around. If you're here this evening, you're not a child of God. You become a Christian by being obedient to the gospel of Christ. That fact, since early 3 AD, has been the same. First Pentecost after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They came together in Jerusalem. Peter preached the first gospel sermon. Talk about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Those people gathered 30 days ago, a couple of million people there. And out of that crowd, somebody in that crowd says, me and the brother, what shall we do? Peter said to him, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sin. So he gets the Holy Spirit. And we know that about 3,000 people that day, they were serious about what they were asking. They obeyed the gospel. The gospel are the facts of the story of his death, his burial, and his resurrection. He died on the cross of the burial. He died on the third day. If you hear that story, do you believe? They're willing to have a change of mind. It's called repentance. They're willing to confess it to him out to believe this is the Son of God. And then have your sins washed away in the water of very baptism. Your lives follow Jesus of life. The ads of the Church of Christ, the family of Christ, it's a bride. Wife is a bride. He's coming back for her. And he tells us in John, in our book, John, Revelation says, Revelation 10, meet our favor with death. He says, I give you a crown of life. That's the prize, amen. I've come too far, y'all, to turn around. Amen. I've come too far to turn around. If you're here tonight, you're not a child of God, we want you to come. If you're here tonight, you're a child of God, you're falling by the wayside for whatever reason, Don't look at how far you have to go. Look at how far you've come. Be convinced in your heart of hearts that you've come before you turn around. The subject of the Lord's invitation wants you to come right now. Stand singing songs.